So I'm prepared to answer any questions anybody has. Sir?
Just as I was listening to you, I was thinking to myself, it's actually your talk is incredibly timely with the conviction of a chap named Karakou in the United States ex-CIA going to jail for 30 months, who was the one that exposed the U.S. government's secret campaign of torture. Bradley Manning made his speech today in his trial. Apparently the U.S. government has lined up 141 witnesses to speak against him. This trend these days seems to extend even outside of kind of conflict in international relations. We see this with Paul Watson, the Sea Shepherd, trapped in on a ship wherever on the planet, and Kim.com, the internet media mogul, who's in house arrest in his mansion in New Zealand, and so on. I wonder if you feel like commenting on this broader expanding trend towards all. It's not just about international conflict or military anymore.
Well, it's all interlinked, and I've talked about the rule of law. Is it alive and well? It's not. Is it healthy? It's not. Are international conventions being respected or not? Is due process taking place? It's under great challenge.
Hi, welcome to Calgary. Interesting. I struggle because I personally believe that there is a war on terror, but at the same time, I do respect some of the ideals you're putting forward. It's troubling the case of Omar Khadr, a man that's convicted for defending a home of which they attacked. I have the deepest appreciation for private property and your own sense of being. The situation seems to be that they filled his house full of holes with rapid gunfire, and he threw a hand grenade over that happened to kill a medic. Did he mean to kill the medic? There's no really evidence there that it was. And for that amount of time in a place like Gitmo, for that action, I don't think it was justified. However, I'd like to ask you, in the terms of someone like Osama bin Laden, Robert Fisk was here recently, who I'm sure you probably heard of, he writes for The Independent. I quote, he categorized the killing of Osama bin Laden as a murder committed by the United States government. He implied in his talk that Osama bin Laden should have been brought to a civilian trial. And I'm sure if I had the chance to ask him, he would probably think that Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, who allegedly sliced off the head of Daniel Pearl, an independent journalist, should also be in front of a civilian trial. So I guess two questions. One is, would you agree with that thought by Robert Fisk that bin Laden was either a legitimate target on a war field or he should have been in front of some type of civilian trial? And second, do you think that Guantanamo Bay has any future use for people like Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and others?
A lot in those questions. let me address it this way. You talk about the war on terror. I don't believe it's not the phrase I would use. But we use that phrase because it puts you into a mindset where it's okay to kill somebody. Osama bin Laden, we killed him. It's okay. We didn't think about it. We should put him on trial. I'm a lawyer, and I believe in due process. And I believe that everybody in Guantanamo Bay should have a trial, a fair trial. Not locked away forever, but entitled to a trial in a properly constituted court. And if they have committed crimes against society, then they should be locked away. They should be punished. But you don't get that. You have over 800 people, including children, who went to Guantanamo Bay. There have been four trials. Is that right? It's not right. We have expanded the use of war beyond battlefields that we once knew. We're not recognizing how the use of language has been given power to governments, particularly south of the border. And everybody's entitled to due process. You know, I'm when you talk about Omar Khadr throwing a hand grenade, At the trial, there were 2 Delta Force soldiers. And what happened was Omar gets put into this compound by his father, who takes off and doesn't come back. And he's put amongst serious players, serious Al-Qaeda players, as a 15-year-old boy. And so is he going to refuse his father? First of all, he can't. I once asked him, why did you not run away? He said, if I ran away to another village, I would have possibly been killed, because if they had taken him in, they would have shown disrespect to his father. And how is he going to stand up to these Al-Qaeda guys?
No, I agree with you.
Let me just finish.
Sorry.
And at the trial, we had soldiers who were reservists, because the military is full of reservists. And they were really happy. They were having a good time. And there were 2 really serious soldiers, Delta Force guys, who had been involved. They knew the business. And there was one called, he had a code number, EC1. He was the leader of the 7 Delta Force people who arrived at the compound. They came to the compound because these reservists were like cowboys. They were going from compound to compound and firing. In fact, they had translators who just wanted to go into each compound and speak to the people and see what they were doing. As a result, they came to the Qaeda compound and a firefight started. And when those Delta Forces arrived, they came into the compound. And OC1 was the person who went towards where Qaeda was. Qaeda was at the end of an alleyway. And this is all in transcripts. And what he did was he went down the alleyway, killed 2 Al-Qaeda guys, saw Omar Qaeda screaming because there'd been a bombing, and they'd already dropped bombs, and Qaeda is just a mess. And he shot him twice in the back. Kill someone else, and then left. He didn't see anybody throwing a hand grenade. But the truth doesn't come out when you don't, or a side of the story doesn't come out, unless you have fair trials. And if we say there should be no fair trial for Osama bin Laden, and then there's no fair trial for terrorism, where do we stop? Yes, ma'am.
I find the rule of law a very funny phrase, and I think that the way that our society is going now is basically a logical extension.
Basically, a what?
Is a logical extension of Canada's history, because right from the very beginning of the founding of this country, we have violated the rule of law. We have violated and ignored the treaties that we made with the Indigenous nations, which are the very foundation, the legal foundation of Canada as a country. And we have systematically violated human rights, not only of Indigenous individuals, but of whole communities and families for generations. And so I find that arguing the rule of law is quite, in some ways, disingenuous, even though I completely agree with what you're saying. Because as a nation, we have never really honored the rule of law. And as you say, we've honored it in its breach. And for us now to be worried about where we're going, it's like, well, we should be looking at our roots to understand why we're going the way we are. And it seems to me that law is a tool that is used by the powerful, by those who are invested with the power to make law. That it is a tool that is used for their own interests and not in the interest of the public good. For right now, the federal government...
Thank you.
But Canada is now considering legislation to legalize what is already legal in the U.S., which is indeterminate detention of Canadians without right to know the evidence against us. That is being discussed in Parliament. And so we are lockstep with the U.S. That was all I wanted to say.
Well, I certainly don't know anything about indefinite detention being debated in Parliament, but, you know, I didn't come here. My talk is not about slamming Canada or slamming each one of us. I have not lost any faith. I would say to you, I've been very proud of the Canadian legal system, for example. The federal court system has been very helpful to Omar Khan. The Supreme Court And the federal courts have been very brave in some of the judgments. But we have progressed as a society, and there are aspects of society and there are aspects of history in society where we look back and we regret it. But do I feel that, that it's the end of the world? Not at all. All I'm suggesting is challenge and do something. Express your values. Make your professors answer questions. You don't have to walk out feeling it, that, that we're such a we're bad people. We're not. Every day in society we interact with each other with respect. That's the rule of law in a civil society world. So I have great faith. I'm not the least bit scared of the future. I think of law as a tool. Use it in many ways you wish, in order to better society. So don't give up hope. It's not the end of the world. So,
at some point after the decision of the Supreme Court of Canada in 2010, and it appeared pretty clear that Canada was not going to bring Tatar back, did you consider going back to court and saying O'Reilly was right?
There was, I remember we said to McLaughlin, a declaration is not going to work. We have a whole history of years of fighting with the government, have given us nothing. Our first Carter challenged it 5 years, a Freedom of Information Act request. It took us 5 years to get to the end. But there was language, I don't recall what it was, that said, and you can come back. And I thought, how do you come back? First of all, there's been the funding. We had no funding. I used my wife's life savings. Nate Whitman used his own savings. In fact, we asked the Supreme Court in Carter 2 to allow us to file our briefs free of charge, and they refused. And prior to the hearing before the Supreme Court, I think it was 5 or 6 or 7 different challenges by the government to strike out some of our argument. They wanted no mention of Guantanamo Bay, etc. And so I thought about that question you raised a number of times. With what I know now and what I learned later, what Canada didn't do, should I have come back before the Supreme Court? I wasn't sure how I did it. How do I do it? And perhaps I was exhausted financially and otherwise. I wish I could have, and I wish I had done it. So.
I perfectly agree with whatever you're saying, and I admire your efforts, and it's really, the law has advanced because of people like you and others who have been raising these questions of law. But at the same time, we have to find, although you narrated history, if you think of Taliban. Taliban was created, they were created by mother sons. They were on the Pakistan border, Afghanistan. And we created it. We created it. West created it. And they are creating, more and more are being created. So the enemy is not in a uniform.
Enemy is not what?
Enemy is not in a uniform. They are invading, they are doing the same to India all the time. They are doing the same to the West all the time. How do you overcome it? You can't use the law to defeat them. Unless some enemy is defeated, you can't change the system.
You know, when you say you can't use the law to defeat them, I represent a famous IRA terrorist. And I remember the same language being used. You know, the Protestants don't deserve any justice. They don't understand. The Catholics don't understand it. They don't deserve justice. That's got to be our guiding principle. We can't unilaterally decide other people are wrong and therefore we wish to kill them. The rule of law has got to apply. I talk about the age of terror, but we're in an age where of fear. Each and every one of us, we're told that, particularly southern border, where I've spent so many years working, and I've listened to radio talk shows. I listened to a radio talk show in Chicago where some of the callers, and were treated seriously, some of the callers called to say that they knew that the Al-Qaeda was at, involved with school bus drivers. And it was a great discussion about that. How are we going to protect our kids? And there was such fear. I don't trust. When you tell me something, I want to check it out. I don't take, when it comes to international law, when it comes to what, I don't take face value. I want to understand it. And I also work from the position that there must be other ways of dealing with conflict, because all we've done is fight. I talked to you about the Americans in 25 years, 40 wars.
Well, I have been one of those. I non-violent work. I was with Gandhi, you know, I was a teenager. So that's okay, but everywhere, this doesn't work the non-violent way.
It doesn't work.
Well, how can you train those people who have been brainwashed from childhood that you're going to kill the opponent or kill the
Well, I wonder if Gandhi would say that.
Well, Gandhi said if somebody kills you, you can kill him. He did not say to turn the cheek.
So let me conclude to your question. I spent an evening with Desmond Tutu. And I remember Desmond Tutu talking about how when Mandela got out of prison, he had the opportunity to get revenge against the white guys. And they discussed that. Think about it. Years of subversion, years of being locked in jail. Now it's your time. But they realized that if they started a civil war, it would just beget more and more violence. And what did they do? Notwithstanding their troubles today, and he giggled about it, he said, you know, South Africa could be a beacon of light for other countries. Why? Because the Truth and Reconciliation Committees travel from village to town, and people were to face the people who had killed and tortured their children. But they found forgiveness so they could move on. They found a way of avoiding war. Thank you. That's my only comment, and I don't wish to debate. Anybody else?
I'm going to ask about homegrown terrorism. We increasingly hear, you know, it's gone from Al-Qaeda, this external thing, to homegrown terrorism. The Guardian ran something last week on environmental activists being called terrorists by CSIS now. George Galloway, a British MP, a very respected, he went to Gaza and paid the salaries of nurses in Gaza, and Jason Kenney labelled him a member of a terrorist organisation and banned him from Canada. Just a few days ago, you could now get your citizenship taken away from you if you're designated a terrorist. This is by a government that designates a peace activist and parliamentarian, George Galloway, a terrorist. Now, environmental activists are getting called terrorists. So how is the phrase terrorism being loosened, you know, and watered down and kind of bankrupted? Because as George Galloway said when he was barred, what do you call real terrorism if you call going to Gaza and paying the salary of nurses terrorism? You know, so how is this new phenomenon of homegrown terrorism?
I don't think it's a new phenomenon. Terrorism has been with us for hundreds of years. And certainly we have an expansive definition of terrorism. We no longer talk about criminal acts, we talk about terrorist acts. And so that confuses. But is there such a thing as a homegrown terrorist? Well, sure. I was in the Toronto 18 trial. I represented the ringleader of Toronto 18 trial. And these kids had bought 2.5 tons of ammonium nitrate. It was a half ton of ammonium nitrate that was going to bomb the Oklahoma buildings and caused all the carnage. The problem about anything about terrorism is hard to know what truth is. Did they get a fair trial? Yes. But what was particular was that not one of those kids had ever been in trouble before until they went to a particular mosque. So there are such things as homegrown terrorists everywhere, always have been. There are people who become so alienated and dissatisfied. I worry about how we treat Muslims, how a Muslim is, and that word is synonymous with terrorism. We don't hear of a Catholic and the Catholic faith being attacked because some Catholic commits a crime. So, I'm not going into Toronto, I'm just saying to you, it's hard to know what truth is. But one truth is that if those kids had been given, had the opportunity to have ammonium nitrate, they would have blown up 4 buildings in downtown Toronto and been found guilty of that. But when I try to understand the background of those kids, I found that it was quite disturbing. I found it disturbing that, they'd all become radical, having spent time in a particular mosque that was had extreme ideologies. But no one pointed the fingers at the mosque. But I'm not there to say that. I'm just saying to you in a very crude way that there are such a thing as homegrown terrorism. Always has been. And the challenge is not to go to extremes, not to change society, but to uphold civil liberties while at the same time protecting ourselves. That's the challenge. Anybody else? Thank you very much.